It's wonderful to be here this morning. Obviously, we made a lot of progress in myeloma, nothing like what has been done in childhood ALL, but we hope to be up there someday. But meanwhile, what I would like to do for this talk is to talk about some of the new combinations that are being used in the upfront setting for newly diagnosed multiple myeloma. These are my disclosures. So when you look at the myeloma treatment paradigm, some things haven't changed. A lot of what we do in terms of specific therapies have changed, but the overall approach has remained the same in terms of deciding, you know, whether somebody is transplant eligible or not. So patients who are eligible for an autologous stem cell transplant often undergo induction therapy for a defined duration, followed by consolidation with autologous stem cell transplant, and followed by maintenance therapy. Whereas patients who are transplant ineligible often get started on a combination therapy that is continued for a prolonged period of time, often with the goal with both these approaches is to try to get the disease to as low level as possible. And increasingly, we are starting to target minimal residual negativity, disease negativity in this disease. So the goals of the initial therapy are fairly common. Doesn't matter whether you're taking them to a stem cell transplant or whether they are transplant ineligible. We want to rapidly and effectively control the disease. We want to reverse the disease-related complications, particularly things like renal failure. We want to do this with very minimal toxicity, and we also don't want to influence or decrease the ability to collect stem cells should the patient be able to go through a stem cell transplant. And one thing I really want to highlight is that most of these regimens, and thankfully this has become much less now, is the early death in myeloma. Up until recently, we used to, you know, again, if you look at the SEER databases, anywhere up to 20% of these patients with myeloma would die within the first year after diagnosis. That those numbers have come down, but still remains high when you look at the overall patient population. So what are the different options that we have in terms of the initial therapy of myeloma? We have several classes of drugs that have become available over the past decade or two, particularly the immunomodulatory drugs and the proteasome inhibitors. The ones that are in blue are the ones that are still in clinical trials with respect to newly diagnosed myeloma and still not approved for treatment of untreated or newly diagnosed disease. The more recently we had the monoclonal antibodies, and obviously there are a lot of new immune therapies that are in the offing, which I will briefly touch upon in the next talk. So it's important to understand how the therapy of myeloma has evolved over the past two decades to kind of put into context the new combinations we are talking about. So when you look at the patients who are transplant eligible, you know, we all started with the VAD combination almost 25 years ago. Use single agent dexamethasone for induction therapy prior to stem cell transplant until the introduction of thalidomide dexamethasone, and then the doublets became the standard care for initial therapy, either with a proteasome inhibitor or an immunomodulatory drug. In patients who are transplant ineligible, it all started with the melphalan prednisone. We used it for almost four decades now. And the initial attempts were to try and make the MP much better by adding thalidomide or bortezomib to it, and also looking at doublets like lenalidomide and dexamethasone. So that, from that background, I wanted to start looking at what are the new combinations that have been introduced over the past few years. Now, the first trial I want to talk about is the SWOG trial 077, which basically looked at adding bortezomib and lenalidomide together, so VRD combination in patients with newly diagnosed disease. In this randomized phase 3 trial, patients were randomized to either VRD or RD for 6 cycles, followed by lenalidomide dexamethasone maintenance therapy. And the trial showed that by adding bortezomib to lenalidomide dexamethasone, it significantly improved the complete response rate. Yes, there was some increase in the toxicity, particularly neurological toxicity and GI toxicity associated with the proteasome inhibition. But what was most important was that this trial not only showed an improved PFS as one would expect, it also significantly improved the overall survival of patients with newly diagnosed myeloma. And these were a group of patients who did not go to a stem cell transplant. Some of them were eligible for transplant and they collected and stored their stem cells. Now, there are other triplets that have been used, particularly in Europe and outside of the US, that includes the combination of bortezomib thalidomide dexamethasone and bortezomib cyclophosphamide dexamethasone. As you can see here on the left, one of the phase 3 trials from the Italian group clearly showed that this triplet is also quite efficacious and with a good overall survival at 3 years of about 86%. The other combination that has been used is bortezomib, cyclophosphamide, dexamethasone, which has an advantage that it does not cause the same degree of peripheral neuropathy that you get when you combine bortezomib with thalidomide. However, it is associated with more neutropenia, and the response depth appears to be better with VTD compared to VCD from this phase 3 French trial. Now, what's been happening, especially the past few years, is trying to see how can we actually make that PI plus IMiD combination better, or can we replace one of those drugs with something else to make it even better? So carfilzomib is a next-generation proteasome inhibitor that has been combined with lenalidomide dexamethasone. This is two phase 2 trials that were done at the University of Chicago, one with transplant, one KRD without transplant. As you can see here, especially when you combine the carfilzomib Lendex with a stem cell transplant approach, almost 94% of these patients are in a near complete response. Almost 84% of the patients are in a stringent complete response. Now, without stem cell transplant, the responses aren't as deep, but still this regimen is quite effective even in this group of patients. Now, more recently, there was data from the Forte trial, which was a randomized phase 2 trial done by the Italian group, where they randomized patients to either getting carfilzomib, cyclophosphamide, dexamethasone, or KRD before they went to a stem cell transplant, or they completely got rid of the transplant and just used carfilzomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone, induction, and consolidation. And what they found was that if you use KCD or KRD, your depth of response is probably fairly comparable, irrespective of whichever approach you take. But when you look at the transplant group, especially in the context of using a carfilzomib Lendex induction followed by stem cell transplant, these were more persistent, or the MRD negative status remained persistent, especially in the higher risk group patients when you use the stem cell transplant in conjunction. Now, the other approaches that have been tried, for example, trying to combine ixazomib, which is an oral proteasome inhibitor, very similar to bortezomib, in combination with lenalidomide dexamethasone. This is a phase 2 trial that we did where we combined these three drugs. The advantage of this regimen is it's all oral, and it's particularly suitable if you have older patients who cannot come to the clinic every week to get the injections. And again, this triplet also gave pretty reasonable depth of response and overall response rates. There's a phase 3 trial with the ixazomib Lendex that should be reading out soon. But the next step in the treatment of myeloma was, again, can we take these triplets and add another class of drug to the triplets to get even more efficacy with these regimens? So the Cassiopeia trial was done by the French group where they took the daratumumab, which is a monoclonal antibody, and combined that with bortezomib, thalidomide, dexamethasone. Again, randomizing patients to either Dara VTD or VTD, followed by a stem cell transplant, consolidation with the same regimen, and then randomize them to Dara maintenance versus no maintenance. Obviously, this is not something we would do today of no maintenance, but when this trial was designed, that was considered to be an appropriate control. When you look at the efficacy of the quadruplet, you can see that almost all patients actually respond to the combination. And when you look at the post-consolidation with the quadruplet, you can see that almost 29% of these patients were in stringent complete response. And there's data with the minimal residual disease negativity showing that these patients, almost 40% of these patients eventually become MRD negative. Now, when you look at the survival outcomes, what you can appreciate is that patients who got the quadruplet clearly had a much better progression-free survival, and there seems to be some early evidence that the overall survival may be also in favor of using a quadruplet compared to a triplet. Now, we have not routinely adopted this as standard of care, again, because we don't use thalidomide that commonly in the upfront setting, at least in the United States. Now, in the U.S., the current practice is to use a bortezomib lenalidomide dexamethasone combination, so the more pertinent question was to see if we can add daratumumab to bortezomib lenalidomide dexamethasone. So this was a trial done by the cooperative group, again, looking at randomizing patients to daratumumab VRD versus VRD, transplant, consolidation, and then maintenance, randomized between Dara Len versus Len, slightly different design than the Cassiopeia trial. We don't have long-term outcomes from this trial, but what is clear is that when you look at the overall response rate, you can see that almost 80% of these patients were in complete response, including two-thirds of the patients who were in a stringent complete response. And this was significantly better compared to just using the three-drug combination. When you look at the progression-free survival, we have not seen any separation yet, but maybe some early trends, and the overall survival still seems to be comparable. Hopefully, we will have more advanced or more mature results sometime later this year for this trial. Now, the question then is, you know, if you thought carfilzomib Lentex may be an improvement over bortezomib Lentex, can we actually combine retimumab with carfilzomib and Lentex? Now, this is a small trial that was presented at ASH last year from Memorial, where they actually looked at combining retimumab with carfilzomib lenalidomide dexamethasone, but giving it for a fixed duration of 8 cycles. And as you can see here, these patients were allowed to undergo stem cell collection after 4 cycles and then proceed with the same therapy. What they were able to show again, as you can see here in the green, which are all, the dark green, which are all the MRD negative patients, a significant proportion of these patients were actually able to get MRD negative disease by the time they get to their cycle 6 or cycle 7, suggesting that this 4-drug combination is highly effective in getting very deep responses in newly diagnosed myeloma. But one of the, you know, a couple of the concepts that are important when we start using 4 drugs in combination, one of them is the current paradigm of continuous therapy till progression. Can we change that? If you're using 4 drugs, maybe we can give a limited duration of therapy and then stop treatment. The second important question is, do we still need to use dexamethasone in these patients if we have highly active combination with the other drugs? So there was one trial that was done called the MASTER trial, again presented at ASH last year, where the concept was that you would give induction therapy with retimumab, carfilzomib, dex, a single stem cell transplant, and then you keep assessing MRD status. And once you get to have 2 MRD negative tests consequentially, then you would consecutively stop the therapy. So you can have 4 cycles of consolidation, retest again. If you're negative, you stop there and go to observation. Otherwise, you continue with additional 4 cycles of consolidation therapy. And what Dr. Costa and colleagues were able to find was that if you use this MRD-based consolidation approach, nearly all these patients can get into a stringent complete response. And when you look at the MRD negativity rate, you can get almost 82% of these patients to be MRD negative by using a MRD-guided approach for these patients. So clearly, this is something, you know, that is being explored in larger numbers in phase 3 trials and probably represents how we would direct therapy in myeloma in the future. And we also tried doing another trial looking at ixazomib with lenalidomide, dexamethasone, and retimumab combination. So our goal was to try and see, can we actually get rid of dexamethasone in this combination? So here we can see the responses when we do treat these patients without any dexamethasone or dexamethasone only for 2 cycles. After that, we stop the weekly dexamethasone except for what they get as part of infusion reaction prophylaxis. And what you can see here is when you look at the initial cohort of patients which use dexamethasone, again, this is with shorter follow-up, we don't really see a very significant difference in the depth of response with or without the early discontinuation of dexamethasone, suggesting that in the long run, when you start using this quadruplet therapy, 2 things can be done. One, we can give patients a defined duration of therapy instead of treatment until progression. And second is we can discontinue dexamethasone very early on. And obviously, these things need to be confirmed in larger phase 3 trials. So this represents our current approach to treatment of newly diagnosed myeloma, the Mayo MSMART algorithm. In patients who are standard risk, we give them bortezomib Lentex consolidation, collect stem cells. 2/3 of the patients go to a stem cell transplant, which is what we prefer, and then go to a Len maintenance. In patients who want to defer stem cell transplant, we consolidate with 4 more cycles of VRD, and then Lentex until progression. If you have high-risk multiple myeloma, we try to use a combination of carfilzomib Lentex or more recently daratumumab bortezomib Lentex quadruplet. And these patients, we take them to a single or double stem cell transplant followed by a PI-based maintenance, most often a PI plus IMiD combination for maintenance as well. Can I quickly switching gears here, looking at the transplant ineligible patient population? Obviously, this is almost half, if not more, of the patients with a median age, you know, of 67. And we know that the age is a significant prognostic factor in myeloma, and this has been shown in multiple trials. The reason why age is important is for multiple reasons. Obviously, these patients have significant comorbidities, such as hypertension or diabetes, which can all be made worse with therapy. psychological issues, frailty in these patients, significantly altered drug metabolism, and social support can be an important factor, especially when you have to come to the clinic every week to get therapy. So, as I previously mentioned, the initial attempts were to try and make the melphalan and prednisone combination much better, and the MPV from the VISTA trial showed that the overall survival was significantly better when you added bortezomib to melphalan and prednisone. This was followed by a series of trials trying to see if we can make it better. This was the trial which looked at Clarion trial that tried to replace the bortezomib with carfilzomib, but this trial actually did not show any improvement by switching the type of proteasome inhibitor, suggesting that DMP is still a good regimen. Now, the other approach has been to try and add a drug to the VMP regimen. So the Alcyone trial added daratumumab monoclonal antibody to the VMP combination. And again, as you can see here, randomized patients to either VMP, standard of care, versus Dara VMP, followed by Dara maintenance. And this trial showed that there was a significant improvement in the overall response as well as the depth of response, but most importantly, it also improved the progression-free survival with the addition of daratumumab. At ASH, there was also updated data showing that the PFS2 was significantly better with addition of daratumumab, and also the overall survival was significantly better with the addition of the monoclonal antibody. Now, we know the results from the first trial. So one of the questions that we've always been trying to ask is, do we really need to use melphalan in the older patients? Just because we have used that as our original therapy, can we get away from using melphalan? So the first trial looked at using lenalidomide dexamethasone against MPT and showed that the overall survival was better with Lendex compared to melphalan, prednisone, thalidomide, forming the basis of using Lendex as a backbone for future therapies. And this was then taken forward in the SWOG trial, which we talked about, again using bortezomib Lendex versus Lendex, again showing a significant improvement in the overall survival. Subsequent phase two trials have looked at trying to make that VRD more adaptable to the older patient population using VRD light. And again, showing that your responses can be quite comparable despite decreasing the dose of bortezomib and also making the cycle 35 days instead of 21 days. So more recently, there was data from the Maya trial, which used daratumumab added to the backbone of lenalidomide dexamethasone. So DRD versus RD, and patients continued until disease progression. This trial showed a significant improvement in the progression-free survival and the depth of response. We still don't have data for the overall survival, but this regimen is approved by FDA and has become kind of the standard of care for older patients with myeloma. Now, one important point I just wanted to make is that in the older patients, it is important to discontinue dexamethasone early on. This doesn't matter what regimen you're using. This is a phase three trial that was published, presented by the Italian group, showing that, in fact, if you discontinued dexamethasone after the first 9 cycles, you actually do better than if you continued with the dexamethasone. So again, this again translates to our current approach for the transplant ineligible patient population. So patients who are standard risk, we again give induction therapy with daratumumab Lendex or bortezomib Lendex for 12 months, followed by Len maintenance. Whereas in patients with high risk group, we still try to use a proteasome inhibitor based combination, often VRD. So I'll stop there and thank you for attention.
Dr. Kumar, for the talk. What is the most cost-effective first-line regimen in a young patient, and what is the most cost-effective regimen in an older patient?
Right. So I think the young patient, bortezomib has become generic in most parts of the world, so that obviously makes it less expensive. Lenalidomide isn't so, but thalidomide cost varies from healthcare system to healthcare system depending upon how it's been approved. So if thalidomide is not very expensive, then a VTD combination followed by an autologous stem cell transplant would be the most cost-effective, most you know, cost efficient, but in terms of, you know, the overall long-term outcomes, I would still use a VRD-based regimen followed by a stem cell transplant if we can. In the older patient population, I think, again, from a cost-effective standpoint, I think VTD or VRD would probably be the best, again, depending upon the healthcare system that you are looking at, followed by maintenance with the less expensive drug.
Okay, we're going to allow for one more question because we're already behind in time.
Thank you for your presentation. Are you using the prophylactic Bactrim for all patients and now the new levofloxacin for that short improved survival or?
Right, so we tend to use Bactrim prophylaxis for all these patients, at least the initial phases of induction therapy to prevent PCP, but we also have been using, many of us have been using a short course of quinolones for the first three cycles based on the data from the phase three trial done by the UK group. So levofloxacin for the first three cycles is something that seems to really improve the outcomes.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Kumar. I'm sorry, it's because of the time we have to, because we have Friday prayers.